Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at biodiesel, or specifically algae fuel. So let's dive right into it. First thing you have to understand, as many of you know, fossil fuel are basically solar power. The energy of sun was used to create hydrocarbon, which we burn in our cars or plane, or basically anything where we use hydrocarbon. So basically we are taking that step and making it short. Rather than, you know, like letting plant mass be buried underground and waiting for millions of years, we are just like, you know, cutting out the middleman. Now, as many of you know, this will make it carbon neutral. If you are using life cycle itself, in a, basically the CO2 that would be released during the process of you burning the fuel will be captured by the next generation of the crop. This is same as biomass power plant, and this is same as my yesterday's video of biogas power plants. So this is carbon neutral, and the only difference between those biomass biogas power plant is that the plant being not the source, we are using microbial life as the source. This is crucial aspect. This is microbial, and what you get out of it is literally indistinguishable on a chemical level from your normal petrol. Petrol is generally not a good idea to make, as it requires extra steps of refinement. But if you compare this diesel to any other diesel, it's more or less the same. This was the inherent design from Rudolf Diesel. Basically, many of you know, he created the diesel engine. And his idea was people will use vegetable oil to run their tractors and farmers. So at that time, he didn't like the idea that there would be companies controlling the petrol and oil, and that will create the scenario where they will have monopoly. So to break that monopoly, he had this idea that basically farm product itself will use the, you know, help us to run the infrastructure that is needed to make crops. Basically tractors that are running on biofuel, basically vegetable oil, will directly give the power to the hands of farmers. Suffice to say, he was a noble man, and for this very reason, every diesel engine to this day, you can directly pour vegetable oil into it and grow up. It will not give you the correct mileage simply because it's not designed to work with that consistency, and not to mention vegetable oil not only has a lot of additives to it, it's not actually refined to that extent where you can make it comparable to diesel. So this is the core aspect of it. It's not only carbon neutral, it's solar power, and instead of relying on plant life, we are relying on microbial life. So why do we have interest? Basically, the compatibility with the fossil fuel cell is the core aspect of it. As many of you know, we cannot make electric powered jumbo jets like this. I made a video about electric planes here, but long and short version of it is that no matter what you do, you can make electric planes. Yes, you can carry people in it. Yes. Can you carry 600 people in it? No, because batteries do not get lighter as you burn them. Rockets, that's the reason they can even get off the pad. It's like, you know, once they start burning the propellant, they get lighter and lighter, lighter and lighter, and as a result they get faster and faster, even though engine is giving the same output. Because they are getting lighter, they travel faster. So because we really need high density fuel, as many of you have seen my video about hydrogen economy, hydrogen fuel, simply because hydrogen is not dense enough. This is the core aspect. Hydrogen, no matter what you do, even in cryogenic state where you have to take roughly 1 kg of hydrogen, will take 11 liters of volume, or you can simply burn 1 liter of kerosene, which will be more or less 1.2 liters. So you're getting density is the core aspect, and not to mention hydrogen requires you to liquefy it or compress it. This fossil fuel in room temperature in liquid form gives you all the energy you need. So for this reason, the compatibility with fossil fuel system is compulsory. You need something that powerful to replace fossil fuel. Can you run your cars on electricity? Obviously. Can you run trucks on battery? No. Can you run planes on battery, like large distance planes? No. Can you run trains on them? Maybe, maybe not. Trains does have the benefit that heavier you make, the better it becomes. So it does have the advantage, and for short distance, it may provide excellent advantage. But for these sort of scale, fossil fuel is the first choice. Now we come to the second aspect. Like if we start making algae biofuel, we do not have to change the infrastructure. Every time you hear about people say, like, you know, for if we want to, everybody started using electric cars, the problem is our grid has to expand quite a bit, and I don't mean like in 1 or 2 megawatt, it may need to expand as much as 500 to 5000 megawatts per city, large city obviously, to compensate for this kind of electrical consumption. So that's a very huge infrastructure requirement. Now, of course, power plant will do that because that's how they will make their money. But that means inherently you can find yourself in a place where, let's say, a small town or small community cannot just go into that because they do not have the power company, like, you know, paying enough interest to them. Just like, yeah, we're not gonna, you know, upgrade your transformer so it can handle more power. So there are many requirements, and electric cars still require a severe kind of a mental block where people think that you have to, you know, refuel it in 5 minutes, but ideally you don't want to use that. Ideally you want to, you know, charge your electric car while you are at home, but this is not feasible with trucks. Many trucks sometimes have what's called swappable drivers. Sometimes they will have 2-3 drivers, or simply driver will switch whenever they are going very long distance. For that reason, we need something that is compatible with our current infrastructure. This is, to give you an idea, this is a jet engine made by General Electric that runs on pure biodiesel. There have been many attempts, including fighter jets have been flown, but fighter jet was flown by mixing 50% fossil fuel, 50% biodiesel. The whole idea is, this is the way you can test it, like, you know, it is compatible. So let's say sometimes biodiesel is cheap, you will mix more of it. It becomes expensive, you mix less of it. So it is compatible to 100% on a chemical level. And this is the very crucial aspect. It has no impact on crop. This is the reason why biofuel gets such a bad reputation, simply because at the beginning stage of biofuel, as I told you, Rudolf Diesel wanted to use crops as output. That's unsustainable, simply because you are taking irrigatable land, the land that will be used for crops, and generally will grow a food crop on them or animal feedstock on them. You are converting that into fuel. Consequence, because you converted the land, now you have either less food for people or less food for animals, which in turn results in an economy not only where your fuel is expensive, but also the food is expensive for people. So this is why you will see biodiesel is starving children in Africa and things of that nature. This is what was sad about it. Biodiesel grown from this sort of architecture where they are farming something is just stupid, bad, irresponsible and harmful. So suffice to say, this is why I'm talking about algae biofuel, not this. This is suicidal, because you will make crops, basically food crops, more expensive because less land would be available. So this, suicide. But the benefit of algae biofuel, you don't have to worry about land. So let's come to, how does it work? How does this magical thing actually happen? Basically, you have to understand, hydrocarbon is made by plant life one way or the another. You are simply breaking the plant down into its smallest component, basically a cell. Algae can be as small as a single cell. That is the crucial aspect. You are dropping it down from tree to, from a complex organism to a microorganism, where you can have a single cell producing a little bit of hydrocarbon. Now the benefit is, because of the small scale, is doing very rapidly. As many of you know, if you have like a petri dish, you can grow like from 1 to 10 to 10 to million in matters of hour. This is what you can get from that. So that is the whole idea. They are taking the plant life and shrinking it down. And nature has already provided us. We call it algae. So the idea with algae is very simple. Because algae can work 24/7/365 inherently in lab condition, obviously. In outside world, it cannot do because sunlight goes away. So you can have a scenario where, you know, you are feeding in CO2, you are feeding it water, you are feeding it nutrition, you are feeding it sunlight. It will keep churning out biodiesel. You don't have to, like, you know, plant the crop, wait the crop to grow. And this, I'm not talking months. This, you, with algae, you can do it daily. Like, you can literally have a scenario where every night you collect the biomass. This product is called biomass. So once you extract the oil from that biomass, then you make a what's called biofeed. Biofeed, you can feed it to animals. It can be used to other things also. Sometimes it can be digested back to the system for acting as a nutrition. So there are some steps to it. Basically, you make algae. Algae does all the heavy lifting. You extract algae. You extract oil out of it. Same way you will extract oil out of other plant products, basically vegetable oil. Same way you extract vegetable oil. However, many people are trying to increase that efficiency of that process. So sometimes people are using ultrasonic scrubbers and things of that nature. So basically, we want to extract as much as possible. And the more you extract, the more efficient and profitable your organization will become. So how do we actually grow algae? Any of you know who dealing with basically swimming pools or open water bodies, algae automatically comes. Like, algae does not care. Like, it does not care whether it's swimming pool or a pond, it will come. So we generally have two methods, core method. One is open loop, another is closed loop. All you have to think about it, closed loop is basically you have everything under control. You're controlling, this has the benefit of higher yield. Basically, this will give you more biodiesel. And this has less water uses. However, consequence of this closed cycle system, it is more expensive. Then we come to something like this, where you just have ponds. Now these ponds are not deep, be mindful, you don't need deep ponds for this. So this is very shallow, sometimes as shallow as like 1 feet, not even 1 feet many of the time. So for that reason, you basically grow algae in this. Algae does all the heavy lifting, and then you extract the algae. Extract the oil out of it, you sell the oil, you do whatever you want to do with the biofeed that is left after that. Either you feed it to animals or you basically use that biofeed to make more nutrition for the next batch of crop. So suffice to say, it's quite sustainable and it's much more energy dense per hectare than even a solar farm. So suffice to say, let's say you covered 1 hectare, the solar cell does not match the efficiency of this. Like, of course, we still need to refine the process so we actually get more energy out of it. But many of you know, algae is like very high energy density. So per hectare, you can get upwards of 1 to 2 gallon in a week, basically. So, and this system can work daily. Basically, you can have a scenario where every day you are pumping materials into it and getting biodiesel out of it. And some of these closed loop system are used as a air scrubber next to a coal power plant. So suffice to say, it's awesome. It runs, basically it destroys any crop based biodiesel. So what are the pros of this system? First, it can remove nutrients and pollutants from basically contaminated water. As many of you know, because of we are our reliant on fertilizer, we created a scenario where we started putting too much of one fertilizer that, you know, helped us grow our crop. We contaminated with that water with that particular fertilizer. And many of you know, soaps also contain some of the nitrates and other aspects also. So those thing in water supply can damage aquatic life, can be unsafe for human drinking. But algae thrives on that. It really enjoys that. That for algae, that is nutrition. That's free food. So ammonia, nitrates, phosphates are nutrition for algae. So understand this. This makes it perfect water purifier system. Basically, wherever you have city sewage water coming in, you can literally have a multiple pond structure where algae is taking care of a lot of things. And small scale of this, you can buy for aquarium. Right now, you can type algae scrubbers. You can get it for your aquarium. So your fish life will be producing all the life cycle that's going on. Algae will be taking care of the basically cleanness of the water. And not to mention the waste that comes out of it. Basically, once you got your algae grown, once you extracted the oil, the waste feed that comes out of it, it can act as an animal feed. That was also a problem. As I already mentioned, some crops are not grown for animals. Most crops are grown for meat industry. So meat industry can really rely on this. So this land won't become 100% useless to agriculture. This will reduce waste. Not only this can be directly used, this also makes this double profit. So suffice to say, this is super fast compared to any other product. Like literally, you can start this today and in next week you can get your output. Now of course you won't get thousands of liters of biodiesel. You will get 1 liter or 2 liter, and depending on your system, some systems can provide even higher than that. So suffice to say, it's ludicrously fast. It's not that you have to wait upwards of a year for completing a crop cycle, or sometimes you can only do one crop cycle per year, or even if you do 4 or 5 crop cycles per year, you still have to wait months and months and months to get your fuel. Here, no such thing happens. So, and be mindful, if you do a mixed use case scenario where you basically feed CO2 that is coming out of a coal firing power plant, ta-da, double the efficiency. So what are the cons of it? If this is so magical, if this can solve everything, it can take care of our jet engines, if it can take care of our cars, it can take care of our trucks, why we are not using it? If it's cheaper, why we are not using it? This is the very thing. Commercial viability of this, while it's there, while producing biofuel is competitive, price competitive as in with normal fossil fuel, it's in no way near the infrastructure competitor. Basically, because you are extracting oil, it's super cheap. And what you are extracting in terms of liter, you are extracting what's called crude oil. 1 liter of crude oil will make multiple liters of kerosene, multiple liters of diesel, multiple liters of petrol. Of course, the weight will be less, the mass will be exactly the same, but density will change. So for that reason, you have to understand, right now the infrastructure cost of an algae biofuel plant is very expensive. That's why it's not cost competitive, and nobody has even made a large scale bioplant. The biggest I could find is only gives out 100 tons of biodiesel. Not enough, basically. Second, this is the horrifying part that I was worried about, and the more research I did on this topic, more I found out this to be true, is that many people are competing against this, not big oil, but biofuel industry. Now, the reason for that, I was shocked about this, because algae beats biofuel, every other kind of biofuel 100% of the time. Then why the heck that's happening? Because those were early to the scene, like, you know, they came in, they invested a lot, they bought up the land, they started, you know, agriculture specific for biofuel manufacturing. They invested so much that they are kind of trapped. They have to make good on their investment, so they are stuck. So they are competing with algae. So it's not getting only competition from big oil, it's getting competition from biofuel. So suffice to say, this is kind of awkward position. And many companies, even though they pledged that they're gonna invest upwards of, let's say, $600 million, they backed out of it. It's simply because of the competitive nature of it. It's like, even though this is perfect fuel, even though this can solve most of humanity's problem today, not only the competition, not only the infrastructure cost, it's just not viable enough yet. However, the more the cost will go up, this will become, at some point, this will become cheaper. And it needs more R&D. The reason why the algaes are very kind of iffy for many people is simply because the algaes that we want to use are genetically engineered. Not ludicrously genetically engineered, genetic engineered in the sense where we select the specific breed of algae that provides the most fuel, obviously. So, but problem is, if you did an open pond structure, other algaes can come in and infect it and, you know, reduce your output. Or sometimes if you are doing in closed loop system, they may not thrive as well. So for many things combined, we still need a lot more R&D. This is not a small feat, even though this has been going on for 30 years. Now, the president, USA president, who is responsible for that, did this basically inauguration, if you will, of this sort of alternate for fossil fuel. It was done during oil embargo. That time, presidents didn't like the idea of, you know, going at war because of oil. They like the idea of having an alternate, having a backup. Now, this yielded the result. Algae biofuel, in every scenario, turns out it can provide us with all our needs. Yes, of course, there are some hindrances. It's not like, you know, magic solution. You start today, tomorrow, all your solution. It will take 10 to 15 years, but it can solve it. You cannot make electric trucks. Why not? Simply because battery will weigh too much. And many of you not know that trucks have a specific weight limitation, not because truck itself can't handle it. Because of the road regulations, there are, like, if your truck is a normal truck, 18-wheeler or something like that, there is a limit. If you exceed 30 ton, they will tax you more. So that's why people want to stay below that. And of course, it makes sense. The more heavier your vehicle, the more damage it's gonna cause to the road. For that reason, so if you have a very big battery, can you make a truck that can still carry 30 tons? Yes, but overall vehicle weight will exceed 30 tons. So the fact we need more R&D, the fact there are other problems with other solutions, this really is kind of stuck in a very bad situation. This can solve all our issues today, but it's kind of stuck simply because of economics. Any billionaire who wants to invest on it simply can be like, okay, I'll just take that money, put it in the bank, and get more money out of it. So do we have hope for the future? Yes. The reason one is that, first, oil price is going up. Even though America recently has reached a point where they no longer solely rely on imports simply because of the new oil extraction process, which we call fracking, even they know at some point, like, you know, this is the same thing as we had with discovering oil sand tars or oil tars. Basically, this is the same thing. It's just gonna happen, like, you know, instead of this 10 years, it's gonna happen next 20 years. At this point, enough oil wells have dried up that we know for a fact that whatever is giving us oil today will not give us oil tomorrow, and rising cost will make this more competitive. So we have that helping us. Second, right now, the first uses of this large scale is not happening because somebody wants to make biofuel. They are doing it for water purification. They are doing it for air purification. Now, this is amazing because this is using algae's strong point, cleaning the atmosphere, cleaning the water, and giving us biofuel as a byproduct. Oh, and not to mention biofeed also as a byproduct. So suffice to say, multiple use case scenario where you will see things like this, where they are trying to clean up the road pollutants, and basically they make excellent add-ons to coal-fired power plant where you get extra fuel because of this. So suffice to say, this is gonna catch on sooner or later, today or tomorrow. This is gonna catch on because this is the best solution we have on a chemical level. This is the best solution. And the moment we start making large scale production, the more hurdles will be solved. As many of you know, in space industry, you can make a rocket in your home that can send, you know, 1 or 2 kgs of payload to orbit, but no point in that. A satellite has to be of certain weight to make a useful contribution. Like a geostationary satellite is expensive, heavy. So that scale matters. So the moment we start making large scale production, we can actually make an impact on the atmosphere for the good. So this was, and not to mention, if we figured out hydrocarbon fuel cell, in the link description below, I'll share you one hydrocarbon fuel cell that works on methane, LPG, but it does not go to the liquid hydrocarbons like petrol and diesel. But if we figure that out, how to make a hydrocarbon fuel cell that can accept liquid fuel, we can really, really help our planet today. So this was my presentation on Algae Biofuel. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, you can dislike it, and I would say share it amongst your friends. That would help me out a lot. And if you have watched till this far, please subscribe, press the bell icon if you are free, and as always, thanks for watching.